I think we may have been looking in the wrong places for solutions. We've known for many years what school improvement is at the school level, what a high-performing school looks like. And we've known all those ingredients, but we've failed, at least in Australia, and I think in other systems as well, to take what we know about an individual school and achieve that consistently at scale. Now, that's been said also for around about 10 years that's a problem. But then we went into designing institutional system lever improvements, such as revamping curriculum design, such as new accountability systems, such as new assessment schemes, heightened professional learning. But in Australia, that still didn't make for a good outcome. So our problem of reform still remained, although we'd seen the difference between school level improvement and system level improvement. Then, though, we've got moved into a more exploratory, collaborative, networked improvement strategy. And that was the initiative I reported on in the system case studies. This particular instance, and it's not unique to this area at all, but there are many lessons in it, involved 140 odd schools over a period of 3 to 4 years, where they moved collectively from being the worst performing region in the state of Victoria to being the most improved and to near the top on a number of measures. Now, those measures aren't comprehensive, but they're indicative of the trajectory of improvement. So what did those schools do, and how come they made the difference apparent, whereas other strategies hadn't? And they did that through a measured process that was a mix of very smart and strategic leadership and collaborative networking and a system of schools being accountable within their own school and across schools to each other. So it was a very elaborate and well-formed process that started with, one, a common understanding of the problem. What actually are we going to address here? What are our issues that we're going to tackle? From that flowed a common language. From that flowed commitments, broad commitments to working in ways that were going to maximise collaboration and sharing. So they committed to classroom practice being the centre of the strategy and to have that based on evidence. They committed to principals being instructional leaders, but then they committed to sharing across classrooms, being very open, deprivatising classrooms, sharing practice, sharing data, and then doing that across networks. And a network would typically have had 20 schools. And while that was tightly controlled from the beginning, and the parameters very clearly spelled out about what the expectations were, the process of collaboration and networking meant that it became an organic and a dynamic process. And so innovation started to flourish. Pride in achievement started to be shared. It wasn't a competition to be better and to keep that information yourself. It became a collaborative ethos developed quite smoothly. And so the networks now have taken different directions. The environment in which the networks operate has changed. The political environment's changed. The administrative environment's changed. But what we've now seen are flourishing networks that that I think are tackling the issue that many education systems face about how to actually achieve reform that is universal, that is sustainable, and that isn't constantly dependent on external stimulus, but it's self-developing and self-managing.